welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, Mario Ritter Jr. has a story on the effects that heat can have on worker productivity. Brian Lynn presents this week's Technology Report. Finally, we hear today's lesson of the day from teachers Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first,
on a hot summer day, workers recently worked to remove asbestos and hazardous waste at Oak Ridge National Laboratory in Tennessee. It is a former nuclear center that the government wants to tear down. The men wore full-body protective clothing and used respirators to clean the air they breathe. But the clothing does not protect them from high temperatures inside the building and inside their heavy clothing. On their arms, they wear devices that record their heart rates, movements, and levels of exertion. The aim is to look for heat stress. Stephanie Miller oversees safety and health for the company responsible for the cleanup. She watches a computer to observe each worker's data, looking for danger of overheating. Miller said, "Heat is one of the greatest risks that we have in this work, even though we deal with high radiation, hazardous chemicals, and heavy metals. The issue of heat in the workplace has been getting more attention since a 2021 report from the research organization Atlantic Council." The group said the United States loses an average of $100 billion each year from heat-induced reductions in productivity. The Environmental Protection Agency said from 1992 to 2022, 986 people died from heat-related causes in U.S. workplaces. Employers have measured heat-related stress by checking employees' temperatures with thermometers. More recently, firefighters and military members have swallowed thermometer capsules. As the world experiences record high temperatures, employers are exploring wearable technologies like sensors and armbands to help keep workers safe. They collect body temperature and warn workers to take breaks when they get too hot. Perrigo, a drug company, gave slate safety armbands to more than 100 employees at its baby food factory. The devices estimate the wearer's body temperature. A reading of 101.3 results in an alert or a warning. Another device from the Massachusetts company Epicor Biosystems uses sweat to find out if a worker is overheating. Experts say the effectiveness of some devices remains unproven, although research has shown that some successfully predict body temperature. A 2022 study said age, sex, and the amount of water in the air make it difficult to measure body temperature. However, Some groups worry that employers will use the technology to punish people for taking needed breaks. Travis Parsons is with the Laborers Health and Safety Fund of North America, a labor rights group. Parsons said, "Any time you put a device on a worker, they're very concerned about tracking, privacy, and how are you going to use this against me?" United Cleanup Oak Ridge is the partnership that is responsible for cleaning up the nuclear reactor in Tennessee. The company says it uses medical examinations to make work decisions. Miller, the health supervisor, said the company sent a few employees to see their personal doctors who found out they had heart problems. At Perrigo, safety official Rob Summers said supervisors look at information on people with several alerts and speak to them to see if there is a reason why they're not able to work in the environment. Adam Schwartz is with the Electronic Frontiers Foundation, a civil liberties group based in San Francisco. He said the idea that companies could keep years of medical information on employees raises privacy concerns. He said the information could be used to withhold health plans or dismiss workers. Schwartz said the device could hurt because you could raise your hand and say, "I need a break," and the boss could say, "No, your heart rate is not elevated. Go back to work." To reduce such risks, employers should permit workers to accept or reject using the devices. They could process only necessary information and delete the information in 24 hours, Schwartz said. Ikusei Misaka, a professor at Tokyo's Musashino University, raised another concern. Misaka noted that information gathered from wearing such devices could result in workers getting unwanted marketing for goods or services. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
Many people are now holding on to their smartphones longer than in the past. This is true for several reasons. The cost of phones has been rising for years, and device updates are no longer as meaningful as before. This has made it even more important for smartphone users to take good care of their devices. But how long can a smartphone user expect their device to last? Many experts say if they are cared for effectively, phones can last up to 5 years, possibly even longer. Chris Hawk is a technology expert with the website Pixel Privacy. He told the Associated Press, AP, as long as you take care of your phone and keep it updated, you're going to get at least 4 or 5 good years of use out of it. The AP offers these additional tips for smartphone users looking to keep their devices for as long as possible. One of the most important elements affecting smartphone life is the battery. iPhone maker Apple says a rechargeable battery's age has little to do with when it was manufactured. Instead, it depends on a complex mix of things, including temperature and charging history. As lithium-ion batteries chemically age, the amount of charge they can hold diminishes, resulting in reduced battery life and reduced peak performance, Apple says. Samsung, which uses the Android operating system in its smartphones, says its lithium-ion batteries perform best when kept above a 50% charge. The company advises against running the battery completely down. In an online guide, Samsung also said that repeatedly letting the battery go to 0% may shorten its life and decrease overall performance. If this happens, you'll need to charge the battery more frequently, and it may last only a few hours before needing a charge. Apple says its batteries already warm up as they charge, so phones should not be charged in very hot temperatures. Charging an iPhone in heat above 35 degrees Celsius, for example, can permanently reduce battery lifespan. Samsung also says extreme heat or cold can damage batteries. It warns users not to leave their phones inside vehicles or other contained spaces in very hot or cold weather. Google created the Android operating system and makes Pixel smartphones. It warns that hot batteries lose power faster even when not being used. Look at changing your smartphone settings so apps and other device operations use less power. Doing this can extend your battery's daily life and give more time between charges. Examples include turning down the phone's screen brightness, changing to a dark theme, and making the screen power off sooner. You can also look at battery usage in the device's settings to identify power-hungry apps that can be turned off or removed. Also, if an iPhone's power level drops below 10%, users can turn on the low power setting to stretch battery life before the next charge. Android phones have a similar power-saving mode. But while this setting can be left on all the time, experts say doing so can affect the phone's overall performance. Samsung says another power-saving move is to turn off Bluetooth or Wi-Fi when they are not being used. Apple, however, advises iPhone users to leave these on because they use very little power when not connected. Many smartphone users already know the benefits of using screen protectors and device cases. Experts advise not using plastic versions, which can damage the phone's face. Device website iFixit suggests choosing ones made with either thermoplastic polyurethane, TPU, material, which combines both plastic and rubber, or tempered glass. Both offer more solid protection. Smartphones can collect dirt and other materials that can block port openings and hurt performance. Experts say a toothpick or toothbrush can be used to get rid of much of these substances. But they advise users to make sure the process is removing the material, not pushing it deeper inside. Software is another important part in extending a phone's lifespan. Experts suggest downloading the latest operating system updates often. This will limit problems related to the device's privacy, security, and battery operations. I'm Brian Lynn.
Now, Brian Lynn is here to talk more about his technology report. Thanks for joining me, Brian.
Of course, Ashley. Glad to be here.
This week, your report gave some good tips for how to make a smartphone last longer. One thing that was not mentioned was the possibility that users can also buy insurance coverage to protect their devices. What advice can you give users about that?
Yes, the report mainly centered on providing care tips for individuals to protect their phones so they can use them as long as possible. And we all know how expensive new smartphones can be if they need to be replaced. So many people do find it worthwhile to purchase an insurance plan for a device. The biggest smartphone suppliers, Apple and Samsung, both offer insurance plans to their users. The way these plans work is that a user can choose to pay monthly or yearly for coverage, and the rates can start as low as $4 per month or $100 per year.
And for that amount, what things would be covered?
Yes, the way these plans work is that users generally pay different rates based on the device they own and what specific coverage they have. With Apple Care Plus, for example, an iPhone 15 Pro user would pay $9.99 per month or $199 per year. So for that amount, a user will typically not have to worry about paying for any damage or repairs that might be needed to the phone, and the rates do differ slightly for both iPhones and Android devices, depending on which smartphones the users have.
And isn't it also true that even when users do sign up for a protection plan, they can have additional costs, depending on what the problem is?
Yes, this is true. With both Apple Care Plus and Samsung Care Plus, there are additional fees for some repairs. For a covered device that needs a cracked screen repair, for example, both companies charge $29 in addition to the insurance plan costs. And for what the companies call other accidental damage, there is an additional $99 fee. Now, one thing to also keep in mind is that the basic plans do not cover theft or loss, but both manufacturers do offer additional coverages for that, for either a few dollars more per month or starting at about $50 more per year.
Okay, thanks again for joining me today, Brian, and thank you for your report.
You're welcome. Thank you.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
And now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Jill Robbins, and I'm joined by Andrew Smith. Hi, Andrew.
Hi, Jill.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
In the series, Anna often makes mistakes. Of course, mistakes are part of life. Everybody makes them.
And I think Anna's mistakes make her life more interesting.
I think you're right. The mistakes certainly make Let's Learn English fun to watch.
Today, we're going to show several ways we use a common word when we want to avoid making mistakes. Jill, what do we do when we want to make sure we have not made a mistake?
We check our work.
That's right. And this common word, check, is what we're talking about today. In Lesson 9 of Let's Learn English, Anna does not want to make a mistake about the weather. So she checks the forecast. Let's listen.
Oh, hi everyone. Here in Washington, D.C., the weather changes often. One day is cold and windy, but the next day is warm and sunny. So every day, I check the forecast.
Forecast means what the weather will probably be like today or in the near future.
So we can use the verb check to make sure we don't make a mistake in the future. Native speakers usually use this word very quickly in short phrases. We are going to give some examples. Listen carefully.
What's the weather supposed to be like tomorrow?
I don't know. Let me check.
You can hear that Andrew combined the two words let me into one when he said lemme. He also shortened the two words don't know into one when he said dunno. Let's hear his answer one more time.
I don't know. Let me check.
I'm Jill Robbins, and you're listening to the Learning English Podcast. When we ask or answer questions about checking, we also say short, fast phrases. Listen to this next example.
Did you get a chance to look at the video I sent?
I haven't checked it yet, but I'll look at it later today.
Jill used the present perfect tense in her answer. This is common in both questions and answers with the verb check.
But if we are talking about a specific time or specific time period, we'll say, did you check it? Quickly, like this. Did you check it?
Can you repeat that?
Sure. Did you check it?
Thanks. And if we want to know if someone checked it at any time in the past, we say, have you checked it? And to make it more polite, we say, have you had a chance to check it?
What does that sound like if you say it quickly, Andrew?
It sounds like this. Have you had a chance to check it?
That is quick. Let's listen to that several times in a row.
Have you had a chance to check it? Have you had a chance to check it? Have you had a chance to check it? And we can also just say, I haven't checked it, or I need to check it.
In Lesson 9, Anna checked the weather forecast, but there was something important she forgot to check. Let's listen.
Hello, phone. What is today's temperature?
Today, it is 18 degrees.
18 degrees? That is cold.
18 degrees Celsius.
Oh, Celsius. That is 65 degrees Fahrenheit. That's warm.
Yes, Anna, it is warm.
Excuse me, phone. Is it windy today?
No, it is not windy today.
Is it sunny today?
Yes, Anna, it is sunny.
Excuse me, phone.
Yes, Anna.
Is it snowy today?
No, Anna, it is not snowy.
Thank you, phone. Today, the weather is warm and sunny. great for seeing Washington, D.C. Phone, it is not warm and sunny. It is cold and windy and snowy.
Anna, it is not cold, windy, or snowy. It is warm and sunny in Mexico City, Mexico.
Oh, I see. Mexico. Washington weather changes often. Remember to check the forecast. The right forecast.
Yes, Anna. Next time, remember to check
okay,
the right
thank you,
forecast.
Phone. Goodbye, phone.
So, I guess it doesn't help to check if you check the wrong thing.
And that's why we have the expression to double check.
Right. Double checking is a good idea.
Especially if your name is Anna.
I'm Andrew Smith, and you're listening to the Learning English Podcast. We hope you are enjoying today's lesson. And we hope you will check out more episodes of Let's Learn English from VOA Learning English.
And if you are listening carefully, you will notice that Andrew just used a common phrasal verb in English, to check something out. Andrew, what's the difference between the verb check and the phrasal verb check something out?
To check something out just means you are looking at something because you think it might be interesting or useful or special in some way. So it's usually used for something you have not seen before.
That's right. And check it out is an informal way of saying, hey, you should look at this. Or, hey, you might like learning more about this.
Native speakers say, check it out, when we want to show something new or interesting. Like if we see a funny video of cats on YouTube.
Or a fun episode of Let's Learn English.
That's right. We simply say, hey, check it out, and then show it. And there are a lot of fun episodes with Anna in Let's Learn English.
We should mention one other thing about the phrasal verb, check something out. Listeners should check the dictionary to see many other meanings of this phrasal verb.
That's right. There are several meanings to the phrasal verb, check out. And if you don't believe us, just go to the dictionary and check for yourself.
Sometimes all this checking makes me tired.
Well, that's when you need a break. Check it out.
Cat videos to the rescue!
Super cats!
Andrew, is this podcast about English or about cats?
Mostly English. But a little bit about cats never hurts. Check it out.
I think it's time to say goodbye, Andrew.
I guess you're right. Thank you for listening to the Learning English Podcast. Remember to watch Let's Learn English and check out our other programs on VOA Learning English. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.